Good evening. I'm Marcia Duncan. I'm the Youth Service Coordinator. And listen, we're very glad that you as parents have chosen to be here tonight. We're going to discuss some very important topics that will help you be prepared to keep your students, your children safe. And in your packets, I hope you picked one of those up. They're out in the lobby. If you didn't, just raise your hand and I'll get one to you. But we have parent information that you'll find quite useful. And I've also included an index card. And if you think of a question, we'll take questions at the end of the session. But if you think of something that you would like Ms. Skaggs or Ms. Sandage to address, or even myself, I'm going to tell you, I do not have children of my own. I have two nieces and a nephew, and so I like to be informed, but they have firsthand parenting knowledge. So if you want to ask a question, you think about it, write it on the index card, and I'll come around towards the end of the session and collect those, and then we'll address those questions at the very end. And you know, the times, they are changing. And technology is so important to everyone today, but in particularly our students, and especially middle and high school age. It's the way kids are educated now. It's the way they communicate and the way they socialize with one another. Whether we like it or not, technology is here to stay. And as adults, we have a responsibility to know all we can about technology and how to keep our kids safe when they're using technology. So tonight we're going to be discussing sexting. And sexting is a new word in our modern world, and it is simply the combination of two words, sex and texting. And it means simply means sending images via cell phone or tablet of minors that are inappropriate and sexual in nature. I will now turn it over to our high school principal, Denise Skaggs, and she's going to talk about understanding the law and school policies in regard to sexting.
Okay. My name is Denise Skaggs. I am the interim principal here at LaRue County High School. My background is a middle school teacher. I did that for 11 years. Then I went into administration. I've been an assistant principal, a principal, instructional supervisor, which was the position I was in prior to coming here. And so I guess one of the things that I would like to start off by saying is that in the role of administration, there's a lot of things that shock you. But over time, you learn that we live in a world that's very different from how we grew up. And we want to make sure our kids are safe. We want to make sure that we give them a good education. And so that's why we want to have sessions like this. Even though we have just a few folks in the crowd tonight, if we can help one person, I feel like this was all worth it, because that's what we want. So we're going to start off tonight talking a little bit about our agenda. So we're going to start off with social media sites that students use, just to make sure that we're all educated on what those are and how that can lead into sexting. We want to talk about the law and school policy, and then Ms. Sanders is going to talk about how to help your child. We're going to look at some resources, and then of course Ms. Duncan said we're going to have a Q&A session at the end. So let's get into social media sites that students use. Okay, the first one, Facebook. Raise your hand if you have a Facebook account or you're familiar with Facebook. That's probably the most popular one. Within Facebook, there is Facebook Messenger that allows you to send private messages to people or groups of people. So that's one that we want to be aware of, because that's one way that we know people communicate. Predators can communicate with students or children, and we want to make sure that we're educated on how that works. Twitter. Raise your hand if you are familiar with Twitter. Twitter is restricted to 140 characters. It is a common social media site. Instagram. Any of you know what Instagram is? Okay, good. What about Snapchat? Snapchat is probably one of the most common ones among youth. And comments and posts that they disappear after a few seconds. Now, one thing that we know from talking with Kentucky State Police is that they have the capability to go back and pull anything that may have disappeared. And that's one thing that we stressed to our students the day that KSP was here to do a session, was if you think it's gone forever, it's not. And if your phone is taken by state police, they are able to retrieve that. So we don't want kids thinking that it's okay to take whatever and use Snapchat because it'll go away. That's not true. Tumblr, any of you heard of Tumblr? Okay, Tumblr is a little bit like Pinterest, for those of you who've heard of Pinterest, where you can pin things or post things that interest you. That's I guess, would be the teen version of Pinterest, Tumblr. Vines, any of you seen Vines or heard of Vines? Vines are little short videos that replay. You could put a Vine on Facebook. You could create Vines and just keep them and show them to people. But they're short videos. Flickr, any of you heard of Flickr? Flickr is a photo sharing social media site. Okay, go ahead to the next slide. I think it has a delayed reaction. Kick, any of you heard of Kick? Okay, Kick is an instant messaging where you can chat one-on-one or in groups. It does require usernames, but it does not require a phone number. So very similar to, I guess, Instagram or Twitter or Facebook, where you have some type of username, but it doesn't require you to have a telephone number in the system. What about Yik Yak? Any of you heard of Yik Yak? Okay. It is location-based anonymous social sharing app. So it identifies your location. Now, what could be the disadvantages of that? Predators, absolutely. And we want to make sure that you're aware of what that site or what that app can do. Tinder, any of you heard of Tinder? Tinder is a dating app. It's kind of like Matchmaker, except it's meant for more of an app as opposed to an online website where you enter information. I believe it is location-based, and so it pairs you with people that are located close to you that you might be interested in dating or have similar interest. WhatsApp, any of you heard of WhatsApp? WhatsApp is probably the most popular worldwide app. You do have to have a phone number. Now, I have WhatsApp. I like WhatsApp. I have family in Germany. WhatsApp has allowed me to spend less money on telephone calls to them. I can send them a message. As long as I have Wi-Fi, I can use WhatsApp. I send a message to the foreign exchange student that we used to host. I can send it to any of my relatives if they have that. It allows me to send photos, messages. I can speak, and it's a voice activated, and it'll send that. Great, I think it's very handy. But again, you know, if you're looking at this kind of from a predator standpoint, do we want our children communicating with people in other countries? Depends on how we know them. That could be a good thing or bad thing. I will tell you, we have instances at this high school where we've had students communicating with people in other countries, and it was not for good reasons. So all the more reason we're here tonight. I wanted to share this website with you. It's called safesmartsocial.com, and if you go to link, it will give you what we call the green zone, gray zone, and red zone of many of the apps that I just mentioned, as well as additional ones. So green means that somebody has said, yep, I think this one is safe for kids. We want to educate parents about it, but it's safe for kids. The gray, maybe, maybe not. It's kind of iffy. But they want to educate you on what that app is, and then you can decide there if that's something you want your kids to have access to. The red zone ones are the ones they recommend you need to stay away from, your kids need to stay away from, because they can pose potential problems in regards to predators or whatever the case may be. So we wanted to share that resource with you. Go ahead to the next slide. Okay, so we know that students use a variety of social media sites to engage in sexting. Many of the ones that I mentioned allows them to transfer pictures, and that's one way that they are sending pictures to other people. It's not necessarily all through just basic text messaging. So if you have a cell phone and you have a data plan or you have a texting plan in there, that is not the only way that kids are sending messages or photos. Photos may be taken at home or at a friend's house, and then students often engage in this behavior outside of school hours, but they have pictures or videos on their phones, and they may distribute them during school hours. And that's kind of how we get involved in that process. Next slide. Okay, we're going to watch a YouTube video in just a moment on how do you hide these apps. So if your child, you go home and you ask them, hey, do you have Snapchat on your phone? And they say, no. And you want to know whether they're being honest with you, there are tutorials on YouTube that you can go to find out how do you hide them, and then how can you check them to see if they're being honest with you. So if you could click on that, and we're going to watch that. I think it's about a 4-minute video.
Hey there, my name is Josh. I wrote a book called Light, Bright, and Polite. And I want to show you in this video how to hide some apps on your phone. And then when you're done, I'm going to show you how to find out if your kids, your students, your teens have hidden apps from you. Okay, I want to show you how to do it first. Let's pretend like, and I don't like this app called Kick. Do you see that up there? I don't like this app. I think it's really, really bad for students. So let's see if we can go hide Kick. So first, you're going to grab it, hold it down. You're familiar with how you do this. Okay, so drag it over another app. But when you drag it over the other app, it should create an actual folder, which it normally does. So usually you can just drag it over that app. And there we go, folder. A little hard for me to do. It auto adds the word social, right? You could change that to whatever you want. But in this case, you don't need to. What we're going to do is take the app that we want to hide from our parents. No, I'm not trying to teach kids to be bad, but what I am trying to do is show you that you take the app, you know, you keep the good app where it's at, you take the bad app and you drag it over one. Now, did you see how I did that? I created a new little baby screen down here, and now it's in screen two. So you have two little dots. Now, the next trick we're about to do is take it from screen two, take it over to screen three. It's over in screen three, and then click the big button on the bottom once. I'm going to click it once. And did you see how it flew away? Did you see that? It just flew away, and what happened was it's gone. My parents can't find it, right? It's like, uh-oh. Now what happens is, Josh, how do you get that back? Well, all you need to do is reboot the phone. You hold down the front button, you hold down the side button, you hold it down, and it'll reboot the phone. When you reboot the phone, the app will appear on page two, so you have to go over to their page two. It still is kind of hidden, but it's not completely hidden. So that's how you do it. Let's go over it one more time, and I'll show you how to bring it back. Let's say I wanted to hide if. I don't need to hide if. Or let's say Snapchat. Like, oh, I don't want my parents to know I'm on Snapchat. So you drag Snapchat onto another one. It creates a folder, as we're familiar with. You go into that folder. You drag the bad app page two. We're on page two. Okay, it creates a page two, and then you got to do it again sometimes. It's on page two. Let's go over to the third page. It's on the third page. One quick tap, and it's gone. I held it down. I did one quick tap, and it flew away. Now Snapchat's hidden. All right, so now what I'm going to do is, how do you get them back? Well, we're going to do this. We're going to hold both of these down, top button, the upper right, and the bottom button. We're going to hold it down. And now it's shut down, and now we're going to click, I think it's the upper right or the bottom, you click them both or something like that, and it'll slowly turn back on. Okay, I just unlocked my phone and here we are. We rebooted it to try and get those apps back. So parents, you can reboot your kid's phone to get the apps back. And what we're going to do is go over to that page where we hid those. And you see the little one up there? That's because I have a Snapchat I haven't read. WhatsApp is there. And then watch this on page two. Whoa, there's Snapchat. There's that one that we tried to hide. So it's back, right? Where did Kik go? Well, sometimes they don't appear in there. Sometimes they appear on other pages. Look, Kik is down there on my page two down there, bottom right. So they fly back in the front, you know, the all over. So one of the things you can do is reboot your student's phone, know that four-digit passcode, and just go around. Now, one more thing we're going to try here, and the reason I'm going to show you this is if you want to find out if your student has Kik, you just type in K-I-K in their screen and you can see if they have it, right? There's another trick too that you can do. You could actually go to the App Store, which we're doing right now. Go to the search button, go to search real quick, and you're going to type in K-I-K. And when you type in Kik, I've showed you this before, that means somebody has it. It's not only has been downloaded before, but now it's time to update it. If you see a cloud, that means your student downloaded it in the past, deleted it, and it's asking to download again. But if it says the word get, that means it's never been downloaded.
All right, moving on. Finstas. Any of you heard of Finstas? Nope. Finstas are fake Instagram accounts, and thus the name. It came from Instagram, so fake Instas. It started after more adults began using Facebook, and so kids didn't want their parents to see what they were posting, so they created fake Instagram accounts so that it wasn't something that their parents could connect to. And they would put information on there that their friends would recognize, but that other people may not necessarily recognize. Can kids create fake Facebook accounts? Yes, they can. They need an email account to set that up. And so this is another way of communicating secretly with someone. And you would want to, you know, be mindful of those things. When we talk, we're going to talk about other devices in just a few minutes. But, you know, if your kids have old cell phones, if they have iPods, old iPods, any digital device in their home that they could then access through Wi-Fi, they can create these so that you don't see them interacting with their with these accounts, because you may only see them on their iPhone or their cell phone that you have, that they have, but then they may have these somewhere else. Okay, next slide, please. We're going to switch gears now, and we're going to talk about our revised cell phone policy for a few minutes, because in light of all the things that have happened here, we did make some changes, and I just want to make sure that everyone's clear on why that happened and what that entails. So our policy was revised because our district no longer plans to confiscate cell phones as a part of a cell phone violation. So we had to take that out, and we had to come up with consequences to give to students if they were in cell phone violation. Now let me give you an example of what that might be. Let's say that I'm sitting in math class and I feel my phone vibrate and I know that I got a text from my sister and she's not in school and she's just, you know, sending me some kind of random message, and I pull it out and I text her back and I get caught, all right? I'm not really doing anything bad. I'm not sexting. I'm not doing anything inappropriate in that way. But we want kids in class learning. We don't want them distracted by their cell phone. So, used to, we would confiscate their phone depending on where they were in the violations. We don't do that any longer. So now, if a kid has a cell phone violation, they either get a detention. It could be in-school suspension, depending on how many times they've already had a detention. It could be Saturday school, or there are also parent conferences that we request, where parents have to come in. It could be that they get to the point that they have been caught so many times that they're no longer able to have their cell phone in their possession during the school day. So that's why we revised the cell phone policy. We do have teachers who are utilizing these shoe pouches or holders. We purchase them. They have them hanging on the wall, and it may be part of their procedure that when you come into their classroom, you put your cell phone in that holder or that pouch. Then when class is over, you pick it up when you leave. That keeps the student from being able to pull it out of their pocket, out of their purse, whatever. They're very crafty. They seem to know how to move their fingers and text and just, you know, act like they're still paying attention. So we wanted to find a way that we weren't confiscating, but yet we had a procedure in place to get them to not be using it. So many of our teachers are utilizing this, and it seems to be working well. Next slide, please. Okay, so now let's move into sexting and the law. I think this is probably the part that I have to say I get more kids ask questions about this and more parents to ask questions. So I think I call this kind of the meat and potatoes of our session. When it comes to sexting, age is the key. Are you over 18? Are you under 18? And I'm talking about the person who has it in their possession, because obviously sexting refers to a minor, a picture of a minor. But whether you're over 18 and you have this in your possession, or under 18, or you are distributing it. Now, distribution is not just forwarding the text or forwarding whatever you see. It could be, I have a picture of a nude photo on my phone, and I walk up and say, see, you want to see this? That's distribution, okay? I'm not necessarily sending it, but I am distributing it in that I'm showing it to a group of people, okay? That's still considered distribution. I mentioned the age. The age is what separates whether the case is considered to be heard in juvenile court or adult court, okay? Kentucky is one of few states with no laws regarding sexting. I'm interested to see if that changes. So pornography would be considered the violation. If there is an issue of sexting at our school and it involves your child, these are going to be the steps that we're going to follow. We will call the police if any sexting photos or videos are reported to us that we suspect are currently on a phone. Now, if a kid comes to me and they say, I think so-and-so has a nude photo of me, I'm going to ask them some questions. Have you ever taken a nude photo of yourself? Depending on whether that's yes or no. If it's a yes, did you send it to that person? Yes or no? So through a series of questions, we're going to try to determine to what degree this is. If it's a student that says, I think they have it, but I sent it to them 6 months ago. I'm not real sure if they have it, but they might have it. It just depends on what other information they give us. The ones that are definitely red flags are the ones that we say, yes, I know that they have it because they were showing it to everybody yesterday in lunch. Those are the ones where we pick up the phone immediately and call the police. We will also notify parents, because parents must give permission in order for the police officer to question the student. We will give the parent the option of coming in and sitting with their child whenever the police question them, or if you just give verbal consent over the phone, then we will go ahead and let the police question them. I will tell you, either myself, Mr. Price, we've always been present during those questioning, and we kind of see ourselves as aiding in the investigation, okay? Next slide, please. So let's talk about, I guess, the consequences. If a student receives a nude photo of a person under 18, he or she should delete it immediately and notify an adult. We know that there are students who send other students nude photos, and that student has not asked for it. It's just, it's a form of flirting, and Ms. Sandage is going to talk about that a little bit more later. What do you do when that happens? It's not like you solicited it, you weren't expecting it, nothing. It just, bam, it appears on your phone. You should delete it immediately and notify an adult. By keeping the photo on your cell phone or device, you could be charged with possession of matter portraying a sexual performance by a minor, which is considered a Class D felony. Regardless if you're under 18 or over 18, it's still considered a Class D felony, and we'll talk about what those consequences are in just a moment. If the picture is sent to someone or shown to others, you could be charged with distribution of matter portraying a sexual performance by a minor, which is also a Class D felony. Or it's possible that you could, in addition, be charged with distribution of obscene matter to minors, depending on what the photo is about. You know, if it's just someone standing in front of a bathroom mirror with the reflection and they're nude and they take a selfie, that's a little different than if you're performing some act and there's a picture of it, okay? That's kind of where they're seeing the difference. Next slide, please. So the heading says, what are the consequences for being convicted of a Class D felony? If you are over 18 and you have possession or distribution of inappropriate pictures, it could be that you serve 1 to 5 years in a state penitentiary. You can face a $1,000 fine. You can be convicted as a felon, which is something that does not get expunged from your record. And you could register as a sex offender. If you have a felony on your record, it would keep you from voting, and it would keep you from owning or possessing any firearm, even for hunting purposes. So, you know, we live in a very rural setting. We have a lot of kids that like to hunt. This could very well keep them from doing some of the hobbies that they enjoy. Next slide, please. Also, based on the details of the photo and what is done with the photo, there could be additional charges. And I'm not going to go through all of those. You can see that they range from a misdemeanor to a felony, depending on, again, what's happening in the photo. What's the photo about? Next slide. So when we've talked about students under 18 that are involved in possession or distribution, they are going to be going through the juvenile court system. They would be assigned a court-designated worker, and then their process is kept private, and typically their record is expunged when they turn 18. Now, I can't tell you exactly what all that they have to do. I know they have to appear in court. There may be some community service. There's usually some type of, I call it training. You know, they may have to attend some classes or things like that. But it varies depending on, I guess, their age and to what extent this was done. But it is much more private. If the student is over 18 and they're the one that's had it in possession and distribution, they would be charged in adult court. They would have to register as a sex offender. All of those things I mentioned earlier about the $1,000 fine, possible 1 to 5 years in state penitentiary, not allowing that felony to be expunged from your record, all of those things would apply. So that's why we say it's very critical that kids understand the seriousness of this. Because depending on their age, you know, what happens to one person may not necessarily happen to somebody else. And we just want to make sure that kids are educated. Next slide, please. Okay, so kind of back to discipline. I mentioned to you that we would call parents and the police if we believe your child is involved or believed to be involved in a sexting situation. We will assist the police with the investigation. The police may confiscate the phone. And I will tell you, we know that they have confiscated phones before. And when I hear things like parents say, well, that's my phone, I pay for the phone. Okay, they don't give you a timeline on when you're going to get it back. If students take nude photos or videos at school, okay, notice I say at school, then there will be a disciplinary action of a 3-day suspension from administrators. You might think, where would this occur? Well, what if they're in the locker room changing for PE and somebody snaps something and we get wind of it? Then that's when we would do that. If they're in the bathroom and they're in another stall and they take a picture or video of something, that's what we mean. When these pictures are taken outside of school, we don't issue some type of school punishment for that. If the student distributes nude photos, whether that's sending them, we actually know that they sent that text message either via Snapchat or whatever during school hours, then it's a 3-day suspension from school, okay? All right, next thing we want to talk about are hidden apps. Now, I showed you the video earlier about how to hide basic social media apps so that parents wouldn't know that you have those on your phone. These are what we call the hidden apps that allow you to store pictures or videos that is somewhere beside your photo gallery. The private photo vault app might look like a vault. It might look like a key or a lock. Some of them have the word hidden or secret or private in the name of the app. So if you think about the video that we watched earlier where you go to type in like kick where he said kick and it pops up and it lets you know whether that's been installed or whatever. If you type in the word private or hidden or secret, that is how you would find out if your kids have installed these types of hidden apps on their phone. Any questions on that? Okay. All right, next slide. All right, I mentioned this earlier about media devices. Do you know what media devices your children have access to in your home? Do you have old iPods, iPads, track phones, tablets, laptops, cameras, anything that can be accessing the web? If it does, you need to be aware of what that is. Do you have extra electronic storage devices around? Thumb drives, SIM cards, external hard drives, disks. Those are all places that we know kids can store these kinds of things. These are all possible places to store pornography or access Finstas or fake accounts. I hope that everything that we've said tonight doesn't scare you. That's not really our intent, and it's not to get kids in trouble. That's not it at all. It's to educate parents because we feel like there's a lot of things out there that in order for you to be proactive with your family, then these are things that you need to be aware of. Okay? At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Sandage, and she's going to talk about ways to protect your student.
One of the reasons that I think this presentation is so important and one of the reasons that we're presenting on this tonight is because I know that I personally have sat through several very difficult meetings with students and parents who had to face a lot of legal ramifications and a lot of school consequences, very distraught, having no idea that sharing of inappropriate pictures could be so devastating. So I hope that if nothing else, maybe this will help a kid not have to face that. Let's talk a little bit about teens and how some teens feel in today's society, a little bit about mindset. Many teens believe that anything they want to do with their bodies on their phones is their business. It's not their parents' business, it's not the school's business, it's not anyone's business except theirs. They very much enjoy the privacy and the freedom that a cell phone or a device gives them from their parents and guardians. And those of you that have teenagers, you know they're attached to those 24/7, right? They also see it in a very different light than I think a lot of adults do. They see this as something that's fun, it's flirtatious. Their mindset is different than a lot of our mindsets would be. I don't know about you, but years ago when I first heard about sexting, I was like, kids are doing what on their cell phones? Really? I was just, you know, surprised that kids would think in that way, but they do. A lot of times sexting occurs most frequently between teenagers who are involved in a romantic relationship. That seems to be the most common times that they use sexting. They sext for many reasons. They want to impress a crush. They want to be funny. They're responding to a sexual text message that they've received. Some of them, like Ms. Skaggs was saying, willingly just send photos of themselves to a boyfriend, a girlfriend, someone that they like, just because, without really thinking about it. They make these decisions without thinking about it. They don't think about how it could affect their future or what the consequences might be from that. So let's talk about what parents can do. The most important thing is communication. Talk to your teens about sex. Is that going to be awkward? Yes, it might be at first. It might be very awkward. But that shouldn't keep you from having the conversations and the discussions that you need to have with them. The weirdness will wear off. My own experience, when my son was in the fifth grade, they were learning about sexual reproduction in class. And he started to ask questions, and I answered them. And his response was to cover both ears and go, okay, that's enough, I don't need to hear anymore. But as time has went on, that has been a very open conversation between us. We are able to talk about things. He knows he can ask questions. He knows I will answer them. Is it embarrassing and hard to answer at times? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I grew up in a home where my parents weren't real open about having those types of conversations. I believe it is important. It is a different time. Rather than making it a taboo topic, let it be a safe environment for them to ask questions, have an open dialogue, know that they can come to you. This doesn't need to be a one-time conversation. It needs to be an ongoing dialogue, hopefully one that starts early and that occurs often. So what exactly do we talk about? Well, here's some ideas. Discuss with your child your expectations, your family's values regarding sex, relationships, and cell phone usage. Cell phone usage conversations also need to include the expectation of how social media is going to be used in your family and in your home. They need to know what your expectations are. They need to know what the boundaries are, what's crossing the line. Also, talk to them about what characterizes a healthy relationship between people. You know, any person that is pressuring a child or a teenager to send them a sexual image isn't someone that they should trust, and it's important that they hear that from you. Boyfriends and girlfriends will come and go, but a sexual image of a person can stay around forever. And so encourage your teen that if anyone is pressuring them to send them a sexual picture, to not give in and to talk to an adult that they trust. And hopefully and preferably that is you, okay? Digital information and images can travel very far, very fast. And kids and teens need to know that the moment they send a digital image of themselves from their cell phone, their tablet, any device, that they lose complete control of what happens to that image next. They are no longer in charge of that image once they give that to someone else. Also, you know, I would encourage that you stress the importance of not asking, of telling your child not to ask or to have or to forward text. And that conversation sounds kind of like, you know, you don't have the right to decide who should see someone else's body. Forwarding images is a major violation of trust. It exposes the person in the picture to potential ridicule. And then, you know, imagine how they would feel if someone did that with them. Also, you know, talk about personal responsibility. Talk about personal boundaries. Talk about how to resist peer pressure. Talk about never taking images of themselves that they wouldn't want everyone to see. If they're not comfortable with grandma seeing the picture, then it's probably not a picture that needs to be put out there for everyone else. I would also encourage you to set house rules for internet and cell phone use with your kids. Review them often. Discuss what happens if they break those rules. And, you know, that consequences are something that you have to determine in your home for yourself and what works for your family. Some of the suggestions are, you know, disabling picture messaging if there's a problem, having limits to when and how they can use the devices, taking away cell phones and computers. However, I would caution you that technology is not going away. It is here to stay. It is going to keep advancing. I am a big proponent in teaching kids how to use it appropriately rather than taking it away altogether. Some conversation starters. Has anyone ever sent you a sext? Has anyone ever asked or pressured you to sext? Do you think it's okay to forward sexy images, and why? What could happen to you if you send or forward a naked picture? What are some ways a private photo sent to one person could be seen by others? These questions are open-ended. Kids can't say yes or no. They're gonna have to, gonna be a dialogue going with that. And it helps you to see kind of what they know and maybe what you need to correct in their perceptions of sexting. Also, it's very important to keep in the loop, and that's what we're trying to stress with you tonight. Know what your kids are doing with technology. And as Ms. Skaggs has already mentioned, so many things have Wi-Fi access. Even little Nintendo DS games that your kids probably play when they're really young have Wi-Fi access. They have picture-taking abilities, capabilities. Things that you really wouldn't think about. There's a lot of ways kids can get in trouble with technology. Technology can be a great thing. It has many pros. I love technology. However, it can be devastating. There can be a lot of consequences that if it's handled inappropriately. Just leaving you with some final thoughts. Some of the research says that 20 to 30% of today's teens are sexting. And some scary headlines would lead you to believe that this is a common practice among teens. And although the actual numbers vary, many researchers agree that most teens are not doing this. They're not sexting. However, I hope we've helped you to learn about the issue and to have encouraged you to talk to your kids before they put themselves in a compromising position. As a school counselor, I talk to a lot of kids. And one of the things that I love to hear is when a kid tells me that they have a great relationship with their parents, that they're able to tell their parents anything. That's an awesome statement to hear from a middle school age student, to hear from a teenager. And I know at this age, friends and peers seem to be the most important when they're that age, but actually, in reality, you parents still have the most influence in your kids' lives. So please, please talk to them about things like this.